Hi all, this is the MakeHaven badging video for the horizontal bandsaw. The horizontal bandsaw is a little different than the vertical bandsaw, obviously because it's horizontal, but another big difference is that it's the head that moves, including the blade, and the material is stationary, versus pushing the material through the stationary blade on a bandsaw. So the way this works is this whole head comes up, the material goes underneath, and then it comes down at a predetermined rate. This doesn't do any angles, it won't miter, so it's just for 90 degree cuts. What also makes this machine pretty cool is that it can feed automatically. So say you want to make 10 pieces all a foot long, it can feed that out automatically for you. So that's a pretty great feature. So we're gonna get started on how to use it. Some things you wanna check before you get started are that it has coolant in the tank. So we're just gonna look around to this tank down here, and there's some pretty gnarly looking coolant. It looks fine. You want it to be, you know, 2/3, maybe 3/4 of the way up. If it's getting low, you can just grab the hose from the water jet on the backside of the water jet, bring it over and fill it back up. And then occasionally a facilitator staff person will add some coolant. The coolant is added at about 10% concentration. So you can fill it back up with water and then we'll just add a splash of coolant to keep it balanced. In terms of safety, in addition to the eye protection that you're always wearing in the metal shop, no gloves. You know, maybe, you know, when you're handling something with sharp ends while you're handling it, that's fine. In general, in the metal shop, unless it's for something hot or something with sharp edges, you don't want to be having gloves around spinning things. They can get caught, and then versus a finger where you get cut, the whole glove will get pulled in and you'll have a really bad time. It's not loud. It doesn't really, you know, it might splash a little coolant, but you obviously want to make sure that all body parts, any strings, just everything stays well clear of the blade. Goes without saying. And in fact, any strings on clothing or dangling earbuds should be tucked away when you're in the metal or wood shop. So we're gonna get this set up just to cut this square tube stock. We're just gonna do it in manual mode first, and then we'll do it in the automatic mode so that you can see the differences. So now you can see these two lights are now illuminated. Power on, fairly obvious, and then bar feed empty. So there's a little switch in here that can detect when metal has been clamped in it. And so it knows that there's nothing clamped in it. So what we're gonna do is it won't actually let us raise the head until there's material in it. So we're gonna come around to the back side and feed the material. So I'm just gonna slide it in here. And then I'm gonna come back around. And then there are two handles here on this side. In general, you only need one of them, just this bottom one. So I'm gonna turn this until it clamps on the material. And so now it's clamped. You can see me coming off, going back on. Obviously, if you're doing something really wide, you'd wanna back off a ways. But we're clamped on, and you can see the bar feed empty light is now off because it can feel that there's material. This other handle is the pressure that the head is coming down with. It's set at the factory. I checked it before we got started. There may come a time where we want to change it, but for now it's pretty good. So we just mostly use the bottom handle. In terms of blades, right now it has a medium tooth count blade on it that could do steel and aluminum, mild, you know, maybe low carbon steel, and same deal over here. So the blade is spinning in this direction. So this is where a lot of chips are gonna get built up, and then they sort of dump down here into this trough, and the coolant also drips back down. With time, there's a little scraper guy here. You can use this just to scrape the chips out into a bucket and throw in the trash. If it looks like the teeth are worn, when it's off, you can touch it and see if it's biting your fingers. You should be able to slide your fingers in one direction easily, but then not in the other direction. There should also be set to the teeth. So set means when you run your fingers along the sides, you should feel it rubbing your fingers. If you're not feeling anything, then the teeth have been smooshed into a straight line instead of alternating side to side, which is called set. The set is necessary to give the body of the blade a path to go through. Something that could do that is these bearings being misplaced. So that's just giving like just a quick checkup on the blade. If you are looking to change the blade, that's something you can go over the with the facilitator. You just loosen the tension on the blade, take it off, put the new one on. It's not anything crazy. Hopefully we can stick to using this blade, and by using it responsibly, its life will be pretty good. One nice thing about this versus the vertical bandsaw or a lot of other tools is that the feed speed is set, and the speed of the blade, but that's true on most tools, is set by the machine. So it's not like your arm is determining how quickly it goes, so you can dial that in to a pretty good value. All right, so our material's clamped. I'm gonna scan back into it. All right, so it's happy, so now we can raise the head. And what we wanna do is have the head raise to just above the material. So I'm gonna bring it down. Something that's important to note is it raises quickly. So when you turn to raise, it goes up at full speed. When you go to lower, it lowers at the speed that you've set here, the saw feed. So right now it's set pretty low. If I turn it up, it comes down more quickly. So that's, if it looks like it's not coming down, why isn't it coming down? It's just clicking. It's because this is set to zero. So you just need to turn that up to a higher value so that it comes down more quickly. So we're gonna have this right above the material, and I'm gonna go to the back side and tell the machine that this is the height it should stay at. So this, it should consider this the highest point. The way we're gonna do that is by loosening this big handle and pushing that right up to this little switch. So there's a little switch right there, and we're gonna tap it against there and then crank down on it. So now the machine is gonna push up to that and stop. So that's where it thinks the top is. And that's gonna be useful for lining up marks on the material. So we're gonna come back here, and now that it's clamped, it'll let us move the material. It needs to be raised all the way up. So we're gonna turn raise. It just pushed against that switch that we set. And now we can feed this forwards and backwards as we please. So let's say we had a mark on here and we were trying to, you know, get to that side of the mark. Then we can either use these rollers to get it nice and close, and then you could lower it if you want. You just need to be careful with the speed so you don't smash the blade. If you are trying to get really precise, what you can do is just loosen the clamp on it and just put it exactly where you want it instead of trying to like twitch back and forth with the motor. So now it's clamped back in place, and now we need to figure out how quickly we want the head to come down and how fast we want the blade to spin. So we can look on this chart. We know that this is, we can call it a carbon steel, carbon free cutting and structural steel. Tensile doesn't matter to us. So the blade speed, feet per minute, is 125, 200. The blade type and TPI, or teeth per inch. So the wall thickness is 1/8 of an inch. And so it's under 3/4. So this is saying 10 to 18 with a rake style. So that's fine. That's ballpark what ours is. And then it doesn't advise us on the speed that it comes down with. So this is just the blade speed, that the speed that the blade is moving at. So what we'll do is I'll put another diagram here that you can reference. It's also in the manual, which lives behind the tool. But there are charts that list various speeds. So this is the manual we've printed out. There's a lot of great information in here. And so this will tell you some of the other speeds and values. Most often, you can just get a feel for it. On aluminum, you can go faster. On steel, you have to go slower. Something like bronze, you can also go pretty fast. So you just start slow and increase the speed to get a good finish. So that's what we're gonna do. So I'm gonna check the speed over here. So the speed is indicated right here. So right now it's sitting at like 250. So we want to bring that down, But you can only change this when it's running, when it's spinning. So what I'm gonna do is turn the saw feed to zero, so I can turn this on. And now, we can bring this down to about 150. So you should be able to see that little red line is at about 150. All right. So as you can see, the coolant is spraying out. There are, so the coolant sprays onto the blade. If you have a weird shaped part and you feel that the coolant isn't adequately getting to your piece, there's also a manual hose. So you can take this and just spray it right on. You can also clear chips off this way, but that can be a good way of keeping the parts clear. In general, for coolant, you could just leave it on. The head, we covered that. Roller feed, we covered that. And we're in manual mode. We'll go over auto mode next. So the reason it's not moving right now is only because the saw feed is set to zero. So what I'm gonna do is just increase that. And now it's coming down with a pressure set by a big spring in there and the speed based on the hydraulic lift that this is setting. Ooh. So at first it was cutting through that top wall. Now it's cutting through the sides, which is much faster, and then it'll get to the bottom. I'm gonna turn the speed down just a little. And then once it cuts all the way through, it'll hit a switch, which will tell it to turn off. And it will stop, slowly cutting through the bottom. Ta-da. And off. Cool. So something I didn't mention is if you have longer stock, there are these rollers that you can move to wherever you want them. Shorter, longer, etc. So that's pretty much how manual mode works. When you want to remove your material, you can just loosen it up and grab it, pull it out of the back end. You could also tell it to raise the head and then loosen it up and pull it out. So now we're gonna go on to automatic mode. Automatic mode, again, is if you want a bunch of pieces of a certain size. So the way it works is this has a little switch in it, and the metal comes and pushes up against here using its automatic rollers, and then it'll click the switch, and that'll tell it, good, start cutting, cut, and then the piece needs to fall. If the piece doesn't fall, the next one can't feed in. And then same deal over and over again. So we're gonna get this pretty close. I'm just gonna move this guy backwards just because our piece of metal isn't terribly long. And then we have this back here, and this is a fine adjustment. So we're gonna move you down here. Okay. And then this adjusts where your little, the poker is. So if you know, based on your piece of metal, so we're gonna try to aim right for that corner. So our head is raised all the way up. So we're gonna move you forwards. And just try to hit right about there. Okay, so then I'm gonna lock this position. Then if you wanted, you could use this as a fine adjustment. Obviously this is arbitrary, so it doesn't matter, but this reads out the length right here. There's a little ruler. With that red arrow pointing right to that edge, so you could adjust it and then butt this right up to the edge of it, and that would be your length measurement. So now this is saying there's just a hair over 2 inches, which looks about right. All right, so this is locked down. So the next step is to put it into auto mode. This is a counter, which may at some point work, so you could tell it how many parts you wanted. Right now it isn't working, so it'll just keep going. So now it's good to go. So we'll click start. So it's gonna cut through. All right, so it's cut all the way through. and then it's gonna hit the bottom, click, up, boom, and it's starting on the next one. So as you can tell, that's a pretty great feature if you're trying to do a whole bunch instead of getting everything lined up perfectly each time. The only other thing that I think is worth mentioning is that occasionally when you're in manual mode, this head gets in your way. So what you need to do about that is loosen that stainless steel bolt so that this whole piece tilts out of the way of your material coming through. So you grab a wrench or just do it by hand to loosen that and turn it out of the way. I didn't mention that this is the stop button. So I'm gonna hit this button after it finishes the cut and then show you just a few more things. Clink. It's gonna come all the way down. All right, cool. So one thing I'm gonna show you is these are the spacers. So similar to on a normal bandsaw where you have the blade guard and it has bearings that guide the blade, this has the same thing and you can adjust their position. So right now they're set as close together as they can be. But what you can do is set them further apart if you had really wide stock. You pretty much want them to be as close together as they can be. So the only reason you would move them is if your material was really quite wide. But you just loosen them, whack that in, and then slide it over. So nothing crazy there. There's a stop here, so you don't go too far. And then on this guy, I don't know if there is a stop, but you can't go too much farther this way, or else it's gonna start hitting pieces on the inside of the saw here. Something else is you can control the amount of coolant flow with these little valves here. So right now, all the way up is full coolant. You could close it, so now coolant won't come out. So that's pretty useful. Same deal on the other side. So you can see that controls the coolant coming in and out. In terms of cleaning up the tool, it's obviously not the cleanest tool to begin with, but if this is starting to fill up with chips, you just want to scrape it out. That's especially important so that the coolant can continue to drain. Otherwise, it'll just fill up. If you can grab a brush off the wall, sweep the chips out of there. Unfortunately, it does get the floor pretty wet, especially if you have a long tube. What'll happen is it's filling with coolant here and pouring it out here. So if you want, you can take your hand, take a, you know, something to clog up the end, shove some paper towel in there so the coolant drains out this side. But unfortunately, that tends to happen. I think that's it. Thanks for watching.